Last week we were to talk about Winnicott, Suttee, and Bowlby. And we did cover Winnicott, but we didn't talk about Suttee and Bowlby. So I'm going to start with them tonight. And then I think it makes sense probably to go then to Erickson tonight. I know that I asked you to read for Fromm, but I want to do a somewhat more extensive thing on Fromm. So I thought maybe we would do Erickson tonight, and then next week we would do Fromm in greater depth. So that gives you another week to read the material that's listed there for Fromm. Also, I have in addition to the stuff that you've already got on Fromm, I have a paper I recently, well, I completed a draft. It's not complete. It's going to be revised. But I thought I would send the draft of my paper around to everyone as well. So I'll try to do that tomorrow. Then maybe you could have a look at that as well for next week for Eric Fromm. So we saw when we turned from Freud to Ferenczi that we were recognizing, certainly Ferenczi was recognizing, that Freud had turned way too much away from external real reality and had swung all the way over to the internal world. And then Freud himself, of course, had realized that and was inching back, trying to find that midpoint. Ferenczi is certainly bringing the environmental trauma, abuse, sexual abuse, back into the picture. Certainly with Winnicott, and as we'll see with Suttee, we continue this. Also, we're bringing the mother. We're shifting from Freud's Oedipal focus. We're certainly adding a pre-Oedipal focus. We're moving from a father-centered psychology into a psychology that, if not mother-centered, at least has a much greater appreciation of the role of the maternal. Klein is a bit of a mixed picture here, and that's why people like Greenberg and Mitchell have trouble situating Klein. Because she's accused, as we saw, by Winnicott and others of having ignored the role of the real mother, which I think is completely false, because if you read her, she's constantly emphasizing the need for the good mother to offset the child's paranoia. And we saw that Klein is not into mother bashing because she is so aware that it takes two to tango or not tango. If mother and infant are derailed, it's very difficult to know how much of the problem is originating with the mother, how much of it is originating with the infant. Infants have temperamental differences and constitutional differences. So Klein represents a bit of a middle figure here. She does not swing all the way over to an environmentalism, that's for sure. She certainly is well aware of the internal world of fantasy and desire. So I guess this is one of the reasons I still consider myself a bit of a Kleinian, because I see her as in many ways avoiding the excesses of either the nature or the nurture, either the outer world or the inner world. She, for me, kind of threads the needle in a way that some of these thinkers, they go a little far in one or the other direction. Okay, let's take a look at Ian Suttee. Unfortunately, he died young. His book, The Origins of Love and Hate, was published in 1935. He died that year at the age of 46. He lived from 1898 to 1935. He was not around to defend his book. He was not around to flog his book. He also was not a psychoanalyst. He was not a trained analyst. He was a Scottish psychiatrist, psychotherapist. He was at the Tavistock for years, and he had quite an influence at the Tavistock, but he was never accepted by the Freudians, by the British Institute. And he was pretty roundly attacked because he developed his criticisms of Freud really clearly. He didn't pull any punches. I don't think he was disparaging in a disrespectful way, but he felt that Freud had got a lot of things wrong, and he wasn't shy about saying so, and I think he paid a price. And so his work was neglected for a long time. Okay, on page 23, here's what he says about hate. Hatred, I consider, is just a standing reproach to the hated person. And owes all its meaning to a demand for love. Hate is a reproach to the hated person. It owes all its meaning to a demand for love. I would say, quotes, and I don't know who he's quoting here, quotes, "Earth hath no hate, but love to hatred turned, and hell no fury, but a baby scorned," unquote. Now that's quite a swing to environmentalism, okay? Hate is a standing reproach to the hated person. It's a critique of the hated person. Its meaning is a demand for love. All hatred, he's saying, is rooted in love scorned. Earth hath no hate, but love to hatred turned, and hell no fury, but a baby scorned.
Shakespeare.
Yeah. It's from Shakespeare, is it?
Well,
okay.
Well, I think it's a lady scorned. A lady scorned.
A lady scorned.
I think
so he's modified.
Yes, hell hath no fury.
Mm-hmm. Hell hath no fury. Yeah. I've heard that phrase. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hell hath no fury.
But
he's turned it to a baby scorn.
Yeah, I think he's switching around some meanings.
Yeah. But that's a pretty environmentalist statement. I mean, nobody hates except their demand for love has been rejected or has been frustrated. All hate is grounded in rejection, the scorning of a baby. Now, there's no doubt that plenty of hate does, in fact, originate there. But all hate? I mean, the point is that I think some babies and some people come to feel rejected when they're not in reality being rejected. I'm not going to make a massive generalization about that, but I mean, babies, children, and adults often misinterpret situations very severely. No doubt a baby that can't, for whatever reason, receive the mother's love is going to feel massively rejected by the mother, but it may be for no lack of trying on the mother's part. I mean, things can get very derailed this way, and therefore to jump to the conclusion that all hatred is grounded in active rejection or abuse or trauma or deprivation is a bit over the top, in my view. Yeah.
So he's really speaking about an infant.
I think he is, yeah.
Feeling rejected.
Yes, and implying that the feeling of rejection is grounded in rejection.
Right.
Whereas we know that lots of feelings of rejection are not grounded in actual rejection. I mean,
is rejection there a metaphor for something? Because I don't know that a baby can really conceive of rejection.
Well, some sort of feeling of being insufficiently gratified, insufficiently loved, deprived, left alone, abandoned, whatever. Mm-hmm.
Not fed. But didn't you already say that, like, babies can never be fully satisfied, or like at some point babies will always be frustrated?
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. And that's the point that I think he is not protecting against sufficiently. Mm-hmm. I think frustration is unavoidable, and I think frustration always yields aggression and anger. And then that anger, if you're Kleine, and that anger that comes from maybe frustration that is no one's fault, that anger gets projected into the breast mother. And she's seen as even more rejecting, more angry at me, and we can get a vicious cycle going on. Another of Suddy's contributions. He really brings the mother forward here in a way that Freud didn't, but with this slight kind of bias, I think. Maybe not so slight. I don't want to give the impression I don't think his work is valuable. I think his work is very worth reading. Among other reasons, there's a culture critique in Suddy's work. He's influenced by Bachofen's theory of mother right, and he has a real he's developing a real critique of patriarchy in this book. This book, you know, is a feminist book in the sense that it's this critique of patriarchy. For example, on page 78, he says, there is a taboo on tenderness in our Western civilization, a taboo on tenderness every bit as spontaneous and masterful as the taboo on sex itself. I mean, you know, Freud is writing about sexual repression, and Suddy is saying, well, yeah, there's sexual repression, but there's this much wider taboo on tenderness in our culture. He describes our culture's anti-emotionalism. Here he's heading in the same direction as we saw that Ferenczi was heading in his essay Confusion of Tongues, the language of tenderness and the language of passion. Suddy's trying to get at the issue of tenderness as well. Another part of his critique of Freud is in chapter 9, the title of which is Religion. Is it a disease? Or is it a cure? He asks. Religion, is it a disease? Well, certainly for Freud it's a disease. I mean, for Freud, a religious person, by very definition, is indicating their psychopathology, because it's wishful thinking. It's out of touch with the reality principle. Suddy is seeing religion more as a cure. Actually, when I went to Scotland for the first Fairbairn Conference, International Fairbairn Conference, that was in 1989. I always remember because my wife was pregnant with my son. He was born in 1990. There were a whole bunch of people there that I met in Edinburgh, but they were based in a clinic, a psychoanalytically oriented clinic, object relations clinic in Glasgow, and they were all pretty devout Christians, Anglo-Catholics, there's a secret Christianity going on in object relations theory. Okay, Ronald Fairbairn was originally becoming a minister of the Presbyterian Church, the Church of Scotland. And the Church of Scotland sent him instead of ordaining him, they sent him to medical school with the mission of doing psychiatry and then heading up for Scotland something like the pastoral therapy, pastoral counseling program for Scotland. He was going to be training therapists in pastoral work. He was a Presbyterian. Winnicott was raised in a Methodist, a very devout Methodist home in England. I think he later became Anglican. Harry Guntrip, who's probably best known for popularizing the work of Fairbairn and Winnicott. I mean, like, Guntrip was kind of like St. Paul to Winnicott and Fairbairn, spreading the gospel of Winnicott and Fairbairn. But he was a low church minister. And Harry Guntrip's original works were explicitly religious pastoral Christian counseling, basically. He dropped that later on, but those were his roots. So that's kind of operating in the background, and Well, you can see it coming out in various ways. I think the same thing is happening here with Suddy. There's a whole Christian thing happening in the background with Ian Suddy as well. Suddy, certainly, we're not devoting an evening to Fairbairn. Maybe we should, actually. But Suddy would certainly agree with Fairbairn, who thought that Freud really put the cart before the horse, in the sense that Fairbairn says it is the object that is sought, not just the pleasure of drive gratification. So he says, Fairbairn says, libido is object seeking, not primarily pleasure seeking. Now, of course, people can say it could be both. I mean, you know, you can seek the object and find pleasure in the seeking of the object as well. But fundamentally, he's saying what human beings are about is object seeking rather than pleasure seeking. And here's a wonderful quotation. This is from Fairbairn. Suddy would certainly have agreed. Quotes, I love this quotation. Autoerotism is essentially a technique whereby the individual seeks not only to provide for himself what he cannot obtain from the object, but to provide for himself an object which he cannot obtain. Now I'll read that again. Okay? Autoerotism, which he means masturbation, but also just generally a kind of an erotic preoccupation with oneself, is a technique where the individual seeks not only to provide for himself what he can't get from the object, but he seeks to provide for himself an object which he cannot obtain. Which brings to mind the concept of looking for love in all the wrong places. I think of these lonely, depressed men who hang out in strip joints. Very depressing places, although the flashing lights and the alcohol and the naked women is supposed to stimulate you and pull you out of your depressed state. I think of these patients I've had over the years who managed to actually convince themselves that the girl is really secretly in love with them. She has to leave me from time to time and go and breastfeed some other guy, but basically she's just itching to get back to me because we have some special thing going on. Mind you, I go in with a full wallet and I come out with an empty wallet, but the powers of self-delusion are incredible. Looking for love in all of the wrong places. Seeking to substitute for the absence of a good object relation, to substitute pleasure. To substitute pleasure, which will never satisfy what the person is missing and looking for. He's really looking for love. He's really looking for a good object relation, but he can't get that, so he's trying to satisfy himself with this other thing. Heinz Kohut got it exactly the same idea. One of Heinz Kohut's, and we are going to talk about Kohut as we go along, but one of his most neglected concepts, and I think most important concepts, is the concept of the disintegration product. What he says is that a lot of the things that in Freudian theory would look like behavior motivated by drive, by sex or aggression, are really not motivated by drive at all. They are products of the disintegration of the self. In other words, the person has had a blow to their self-esteem, and they're derailed, and they're falling apart. And they try to pull themselves together using sex or aggression, or a combination of sex and aggression. He's had a blow to his self-esteem, so he heads off to hookers or strip bars, or if he's homosexual, to cruising, bathhouses, whatever, or cocaine, or alcohol, or whatever it is. Yeah.
And this isn't Thanatos or a death instinct? This is a disintegration of self? How are they distinct from one another?
Maybe I repeat the question.
Oh, the question is, this isn't a death instinct, Thanatos, or is it a disintegration, or how are these connected? I have trouble answering the question because I've never been able to make anything out of the death instinct. I don't know what the death instinct is. I've never been able to accept it as Freud proposed it, that is, as a primary biological need to die. I mean, people forget that that's what Freud meant.
So it's not self-destruction.
Well, self-destruction, from Freud's original use of death instinct, self-destruction would be death instinct projected out and then coming back at me and taken over by my superego and turned into self-destruction, although there would be a primary masochistic tendency to die. But I don't think the primary masochistic tendency to die, as Freud proposed it, would be enough to actually account for active self-destruction. He might see that as the bottom layer, but I think Freud would have seen active self-destruction as aggression turned on the self. So he would have seen it as a combination of primary masochism, death instinct, and secondary masochism, aggression turned against the self. I think that's the way he would. But to simply think of that complicated picture, to call that death instinct, I can't relate to that idea. The disintegration product. Certainly Kohut would have no truck with any idea of a death instinct. For him, the disintegration product is not something that one is seeking. Now, of course, this, I would say, is a limitation of self-psychology. You see, he sees the person's disintegration as brought about by some self-object failure. Okay, we need to be mirrored by others. Our self-esteem needs to be supported by responses from others. And if I have a negative response, or if I don't have the self-object response, the empathic, loving response that I'm looking for, if I am a disintegration-prone personality, what's that? Well, for Kohut, that's a person whose self has never come together properly in the first place because of failure on the part of the early self-object. Now, here is your extreme environmentalism again, okay? Suttee would be on side with Kohut. Kohut would be on side with Suttee here. The reason the person has a disintegration-prone self is because their self is half-baked. It never got fully baked in the kiln of the early self-objects. And for Kohut, you have two chances to fully bake a self, you know? One is with the mother. And if it fails with mother, you can turn to father, if father's available, and you get a second chance. He calls the mother the mirroring self-object. Look, ma, no hands. She's supposed to have a beam in her eye. And if I get that, I can come together. If it doesn't work with mother, I can turn to father. And I can idealize father. And I can merge into his strength and his calmness. And I can put together a self through that connection with him. But if he's not there, and if it didn't work with mother, I am left with a disintegration-prone self. In other words, I'm left with what used to be called a narcissistic personality disorder. But which Kohut thought that phrase had a moralistic ring to it. And of course he was right, because the early Freudians were moralistic about narcissistic personalities. I benefited a great deal from my work with my first analyst. But he pretty much had that attitude. His attitude towards my narcissism was more or less along the lines, "What makes you think your shit doesn't stink, Carvath?" Okay. And I remember the day, I mean, I started analysis because I was having trouble publishing, among other problems I was having. And finally, after, you know, a year of analysis, I published two big articles in American journals. which finally made the U of T sit up and agree to let me do the thesis I wanted to. And more or less they said, you've got your thesis, add an introduction, a conclusion, we'll give you a PhD. But I was so proud of having written these two articles because they represented overcoming my writer's block. And I came into his office and told him about this, bragging, of course. And he was silent. And then finally he leans forward and he says, Professor Carveth, two swallows does not a summer make. you know, I mean, all I wanted was good going, kid. But no way. No way, you know. Because his view of narcissism is, you think your shit doesn't stink. He thought of it as a kind of the Freudians thought of it as an infantilism. You needed to grow up. Right? It was not seen as an illness, narcissism. Heinz Kohut made a great contribution because, you know, he got us finally to understand that narcissism is a form of psychopathology. It's an illness. It needs treatment. Yeah.
It's true, but it's still very moralistic. Like, I feel like some of the personality disorders, like, we still moralize about, like, borderline, narcissistic, like, the whole
yeah. Well, he tried to get over that by renaming narcissistic personality disorder. He called it self-disorders. But you still got the word disorder there. But nevertheless, I don't know how you're going to avoid that entirely. There's someone standing there like they're looking lost. Oh, you're just waiting. Okay. I mean, it's recognized, whether you call it narcissistic or self-disorder, I mean, these are people who are suffering from inadequate self-esteem regulation. And
yeah. Just when you have something like PTSD, it's also called a disorder, but when you call it post-traumatic, it just sounds like, oh, you're struggling because you suffered from this
right.
trauma. And
I
so
hear you.
Narcissism or self-disorder... It just sounds like, oh, you're just a bad disordered person.
Yeah, I hear you about that. In case people online, it says your device is about to restart. Cancel. Okay. Could you online hear the question? No, you couldn't hear the question. Let me repeat it. He's saying that calling something a self-disorder or a narcissistic disorder sounds moralistic, whereas calling something PTSD, post-traumatic, it's less moralistic. It seems to convey more empathy. I agree. I think you could actually make a case that self-disorders or narcissistic disorders are post-traumatic disorders. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's exactly what Kohut says, too. I mean, you know, he's saying that there were early failures on the part of the early self-objects. But then again, I immediately have to point out the one-sidedness of this, because it's parent-bashing.
I feel like we failed the community. Like, when you go online and you look at narcissism or narcissistic personality, it's like a nightmare. Like, people with narcissism are described like demons. Like, there are these people
yes.
that you need to, like, get out of the community. You have to run away from. Like, they're just
yes.
nightmares. And I feel like a lot of that has come from psychoanalysis and from our profession. Like, we defined narcissism, and now we've created this community outrage.
We might have been able to define and talk about these things in less moralistic terms. On the other hand, I don't think that makes us responsible for the lunatics who take some of our ideas and go crazy with them.
Yeah.
I think also online narcissistic personality disorder is often confused with psychopathy.
Mm-hmm.
And you can understand why, because psychopathy is simply extreme narcissism. Psychopathy is malignant narcissism. But people seem to, you know, have lost sight of the fact that there's all kinds of narcissistic disorders that are that don't resemble psychopathy at all. And these are suffering people who need help with their self-esteem regulation. Yeah. Okay, the disintegration product. So here is someone whose problem is that he's falling apart. He's in desperate need of love. He's in desperate need of empathy. of recognition, of holding, of containment, and he can't find it. And so he's falling apart. So he turns to a substance or to some form of driven sex, which isn't about drive at all. Or he turns to hate. Some people hold themselves together with hate. Their hate is not anything like an aggressive drive. It's that they're using anger and hatred to keep themselves from fragmenting to a psychotic kind of degree. Yeah.
Okay, so are they using drugs or sex or whatever to fill a void or to distract themselves from how they feel?
Well, those are not contradictions. You can use something to distract yourself from a void. These are people who feel very often great emptiness inside.
Right. That's why I didn't know.
Eating disorders.
Which one?
I mean, people can turn to food to try to fill the great emptiness inside.
Yeah.
There's so many different ways to try to fill this hole inside the self, right? Yeah. Okay. Disintegration product. Well, I'm tempted to go off on Kohut now, but I think I'll wait till a later seminar, and we'll come back to Kohut, and we'll discuss Kohut in relation to Kernberg, because there was a famous big debate between Kohut and Kernberg in the 1970s, and so we'll come back to Kernberg. I want to, we've talked about Winnicott. Let me say one more word about Winnicott. And I think I made this point last week, but it's worth making again. There's a sense in which Winnicott, I think, does avoid this one-sidedness, this swing from nature to nurture. Because he is such an unsystematic thinker, as I pointed out last week, he will write a kind of a Kleinian paper, and then in the same year he'll write a paper that sounds like Heinz, a precursor of Heinz Kohut. He'll write what really seems to be a very environmentalistic paper. It's all about pathology resulting from failures of the holding environment, pathologies of the self resulting from not good enough mothering, pathologies of the self resulting from intrusion and deprivation on the part of the early objects. So there he's with Suttie, there he's with Kohut, and so on. But in the same year he will write on the capacity for concern, which is a Kleinian paper, about moving out of the narcissism of the paranoid schizoid position and acquiring the capacity to see other people as real and care about them, not just about oneself. So his very unsystematic nature means that he ends up writing on both sides of this split. How do we characterize the split? There are those who just emphasize, again, there are Freudians who emphasize the drives, there are Kleinians who put a lot of the emphasis on the internal world of fantasy and distortion. And then there's this other wing that puts everything down to early failure on the part of caretakers. You could say that the Freudian-Kleinian approach, even though sometimes it grounds its thinking, I think, falsely in drive, ideas of biology and of drive, it's a little closer to a kind of existentialism. It mistheorizes existentialism. What I mean by existentialism is simple. It's the recognition that things go wrong that are nobody's fault. That there are things that go wrong. There is pain that human beings suffer that is nobody's fault. That's not to say that there isn't pain that is somebody's fault. There's lots of pain that is somebody's fault. But in addition to the pain that is somebody's fault, there is pain that is nobody's fault. that is just a part of the human condition. And I think the Freudians and Kleinians kind of get at that, even though they sometimes mistheorize it. They say that it's grounded in biology. I don't think it's grounded drive that's grounded in biology, but I think it's grounded in inevitable suffering. It's grounded in unavoidable frustration that then generates rage. I think the Freudians and Kleinians get that. And because they understand that to be human is to suffer, to some degree or another, and not all of it is anybody's fault, because they understand that, they don't get into the same kind of one-sided parent bashing that the strictly relational people get into. I think the relational people have made really important contributions, but it's sometimes they lose that existential element. By the way, Eric Fromm hangs on to this existential element big time. I mean, Fromm is an existentialist. And a lot of the relational people who like Fromm, they lose his existentialism. They forget about his existentialism. They want to think of him as a Marxist. Well, he was a Marxist, but he was an existential Marxist. Yeah. It's interesting. Marxists have trouble with Fromm, and they have trouble with Jean-Paul Sartre for exactly the same reason, because both Fromm and Sartre were existential neo-Marxists. They were existentialist Marxists. They understood that there's something in the human condition which is like maddening. There's something in the human condition that's maddening that is nobody's fault. And I think the relational tradition kind of loses that sometimes, which is why I appreciate Klein as much as I do. Okay, so we're talking about this move to understand the role of the mother much more than Freud did. So let's come to Bowlby and attachment theory now. Well, let's start with Bowlby's understanding of the child's tie to the mother. Well, before we do that, let's back up and understand Freud's understanding of the child's tie to the mother. Why do children get attached to their mothers, says Freud? Because the mother is a feeder. Because fundamentally, the baby wants to satisfy his hunger and his other biologically based needs. And so, you know, he doesn't have any primary need to attach to the mother. Freud's is a secondary drive theory. It's a learned drive theory. It's like behaviorism. It's like classical conditioning. I learn to like mother because mother is a feeder. She satisfies my oral drive, therefore I get attached to her. In other words, for Freud, mother is merely a means to an end. She's not an end in herself. She's a means to the end of satisfying my hunger drive. She's a means to an end. That's like a learning theory. You know, we learn to get attached. The same way the dog learns to salivate at the bell instead of just the presentation of the food. Now, Freud is like a behavioral learning theorist here about the child's attachment to the mother. Bowlby says, no, this is all wrong. The child comes into the world with a biologically built-in need and proclivity to attach to the mother. It's not a learning thing at all. We're primates. And just as the baby duckling, when it pecks its way out of the egg, imprints on Conrad Lorenz or the mother duck or the dog or the ping pong ball, so we come into the world all primed to attach to the mother. It's not learning particularly. This is real instinct theory. This is real drive theory. Okay. In that sense, mother is an end in herself. She's not merely a means to the satisfaction of other drives. Again, this is like Fairbairn saying the child is is object-seeking. The child comes into the world object-seeking, not merely pleasure-seeking. So, attachment is an unlearned, innate, biologically given need to attach. Mother is not merely a means to an end. More broadly, what are the implications of this? Against Freud, our sociality is not acquired or imposed upon our asocial biological nature. I mean, that's Freud's view. Our sociality is something that's imposed, that's acquired, that's an overlay upon our basically asocial nature. For Bowlby, no. We are naturally social. Yes?
So does Klein merge the two approaches by having the paranoid schizoid position in which the mother is a means, right? And then...
How is the mother a means in the paranoid schizoid?
Well, she's either a good...
Oh, sorry, the question... Can we hand you the mic, and then I won't have to repeat the question, if you can... Sorry, Mike, I'll just pass it down.
So, what I'm wondering here is, with Klein, does she merge between these two sort of perspectives? Because she's describing, in the paranoid schizoid position, how the baby sees the mother as either being a good mother or a bad mother.
Right, right.
And in a sense, she's sort of objectified. Versus the depressive position, where the child sees the mother as a whole being.
Yeah.
And is no longer just a means to food or safety.
Right.
Is that possible? Would that be one way of seeing it?
I have to think about that. Like, in the paranoid schizoid position, is the mother seen as merely a means? Like, what would Klein think? What would Klein think? You see, I think Klein is closer to Bowlby than that. I mean, Bowlby reacted strongly against Klein, along the same lines as Winnicott did. I think unfairly. Okay. So I'm trying to say that I think that there's a sense in which Klein... That Klein is not so far away from Bowlby as we would imagine. I mean, Klein... Okay, listen, I can quote Melanie Klein. Klein says the baby comes into the world with a faith or a belief that an object of incomparable goodness exists, namely the mother's breast. The baby comes into the world with a belief that an object of incomparable goodness exists, the mother's breast. Okay, so that means for Klein, the baby is already somehow hardwired, or it's in the nature of the baby to believe in the mother and to be ready to find the mother. And to be ready to attach to the mother. I think a kind of a... See, this is much closer to Bowlby than Freud was. Klein is not saying that the baby only gets attached to the mother because it learns that the mother is a feeding thing. That's not Klein. So, I think that's the best I can do in answer to your question. Okay, to... So I was also making the point that from an attachment theory point of view, unlike Freud, our sociality is not acquired or imposed upon our basic nature, our basic asocial nature. We are naturally social by nature. Bowlby reminds us that we're primates. I find this incredibly important because I come out of sociology and social and political thought, which for decades has been so steeped in what we can call sociologism, social constructionism, social determinism, the linguistic turn, man is a language animal, blah, 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 blah. Foucault is insane. You know, I mean, thinking that, you know, he talks about the death of man, the death of any concept of a human nature. All we have is man as produced by this episteme or that episteme. There is no, this is the death of humanism. There is no universal human nature. All we have are human beings as created by particular social orders. This is extreme social constructionism. This has always been the bias. We don't need it. Okay. This has always been the bias of the disciplines of sociology and anthropology. And I was resisting it early on. Interestingly enough, Eric Fromm resists it. Because Fromm is a Marxist. He follows Karl Marx. And Marx distinguishes human nature in general from human nature as shaped by particular social and historical orders. So Marx is a critic of the kind of essentializing that mistakes man under capitalism for man as such. You know, Marx resists this kind of ethnocentrism that confuses a particular cultural formation with human nature as such. But he does insist that there are certain universal elements of the human condition. There is a human nature in general, but we only know that human nature in general through its various manifestations under particular historical and cultural conditions. In other words, Karl Marx threads the needle. He doesn't succumb to a one-sided essentialism. Neither does he succumb to a complete social determinism. He occupies this third position, and Eric Fromm quotes him. And therefore, Fromm's position is called a qualified essentialism, a qualified essentialism that strives to do justice both to the historical and cultural formation, but also recognize the universals. And therefore, Fromm is able to posit certain universal human needs, and then he's able to rank societies in terms of how well they satisfy or fail to satisfy those universal human needs. So he's now got a basis for a critique of society. Of societies for the ways in which they either satisfy or don't satisfy particular human needs. Anyway, Bowlby reminds us that we're animals, that we're primates, as does Chomsky. Chomsky has tremendous credentials as a left thinker. His early work in linguistics argues that, you know, are pretty persuasively that language is grounded in biology, in the architecture of the brain, and, you know, it's not simply a social acquisition. We acquire language because we have brains that are formed in a certain way that are ready to acquire language. Along these same lines, there's this really interesting research done at the Yale School of Infant Studies. Bloom is the author, on early moral development. I don't think I've talked about that here. I won't go into it in detail, but they have these ingenious experiments where, I think I did talk about it, the baby is held by the mother and there's a little theater and the curtain opens and the baby views this particular scene, and there's a helpful rabbit and there's a thwarting rabbit, and then the two rabbits are brought out on a tray and the baby is allowed to choose, and invariably they choose the helpful rabbit, not the the frustrating rabbit, although that starts to vary. They put cookies or something on the plate, and sometimes you can get the kid to choose the bad rabbit if there are enough cookies, but overwhelmingly its urge is to choose the good rabbit. Okay, and that's at 3 months of age. Now at 3 months the kids have already had time for some socialization, and some time to identify with the kindness and the nurturance of the mother, But, you know, to read the social science literature, you would think from decades that that the formation of superego or conscience is entirely a social product that comes with language. Here are babies long before language, showing preferences for good over bad. In current social theory, there is a real reaction against the extremes of post-structuralism and postmodernism, and there's an attempt to surpass all of that now, which I'm very happy to see, without swinging back to some kind of ridiculous biological determinism or essentialism. You know, we have to transcend these dichotomies. But Bowlby makes an important contribution. Okay, so then we have the Toronto connection, Mary Ainsworth, and Blatz, Sidney Blatz, who ran the Institute of Child Study here at the University of Toronto. Many of Ainsworth's ideas are almost identical to Blatz's ideas. I mean, you know, she just elaborated on some of Blatz's ideas regarding different attachment styles. Anyway, Ainsworth is the author of The Strange Situation Test. I imagine everybody knows about this. Does anyone need me to describe briefly?
I think probably nobody knows about it.
Nobody knows.
I don't know what you're talking about.
All right, okay. So Mary Ainsworth came up with The Strange Situation Test. So these are kids who are what age, Elizabeth?
1 year of age.
1 year of age. They're brought in by their mothers into a little experimental room, and initially there are four observing phases. The mother is in there alone with the baby, and then the stranger enters, mm-hmm. and so you observe now the way the baby is reacting to the stranger coming in.
Who's talking to the mother?
Who's talking to the mother. And then in the next situation, the mother leaves, and the baby is now alone with the stranger. Mm-hmm. And then in the final one, mother comes back in.
Mm-hmm. And the focus is on the reunion behavior of the infant with the mother.
How the kid reacts to mother's re-entry.
Yeah.
Having been left with the stranger, mother comes back in.
Without the stranger there?
Stranger leaves.
Stranger leaves, mother
then
comes back.
Just to make it more complicated, it's repeated again.
Okay.
To see if the same reaction happens?
But to see what reaction happens.
Right.
And again, the focus is on the reunion behavior.
Right.
Reunion behavior, right. And so initially they came up with three different classifications based on the way the kid reacts. Well, there's secure attachment, where the kid is not overly distressed in any of these situations. When mother comes back, he may just look up and reference her, and that might be enough. Or he might get up and go over and lean against her knees a bit and then drop back down and continue his play. So that's secure attachment. And then there is insecure avoidant and insecure anxious. So insecure, anxious, or ambivalent, mm-hmm. ambivalent attachment. When mother comes back, the kid gets up and goes over to mother and maybe hits her. He's angry at her for having left him with this stranger. So he's showing some anger, ambivalence. And then there's insecure avoidant. Do you want to explain
resistant.
That?
Yeah, that the child avoids.
Just avoids the mother.
Yeah.
He just
the mother comes in, the child doesn't even look up.
Right.
Like, who cares?
Yeah.
You left me.
Indifferent to the whole thing.
Are these terminologies Bowlby's or Ainsworth?
Ainsworth. Okay. And then finally, there's a fourth category added on by Mary Main.
Mm-hmm. Disorganized.
Which is disorganized attachment. And do you want to describe what that looks like?
Yeah, that looks really weird. The child comes back into the room. Or sorry, the mother comes back into the room. The child is very upset when the mother leaves, but once the mother comes back in the room, the child isn't able to settle. and the mother isn't able to settle a child. Mm. And what precedes that is the stranger has come into the room, and the child spends more time being interested in the stranger. And when the mother leaves the room, the child doesn't even notice that the mother's left the room. And then the child realizes the mother's left the room and starts to fall apart, and the stranger can do nothing. And the hardest thing for the stranger is not to pick up the child, mm-hmm. because the strangers feel that they have caused this whole thing, and they want to comfort the child. And the minute you pick up the child, you ruin the test. Mm-hmm. So the stranger has to use words, toys, anything. And usually this is not, these segments are 3 minutes long, but if the child is distressed, then you stop the segment and you bring the mother back into the room. Yeah. And so the theory behind that is that the child is disorganized and does not have strategy of what to do. And of course, what's matching is on these attachment categories is the parent's attachment category fits. So you get a disorganized child from, would be a disorganized mother, but it's called unresolved. So there you get these fits. So the child just doesn't become this way by themselves. They actually have been in the relationship with the other, the mother.
So maybe I could elaborate on that aspect of it. So we've shifted now to the adult attachment interview. This is Mary Main's work, and so you give an ad, you interview the adult for about a half an hour, and it's a tape recorded interview, and you're asking this adult about their own personality, their problems, their relationships, their object relations. And about their childhood and how they understand the problems that they're having now or that they have managed to resolve over the years and how that reflects their understanding of their childhood and the events of their childhood. And the interesting thing is these interviews are then recorded not for content but for the structure. The almost the linguistic structure, the cohesiveness and the coherence of the narrative. Okay, it's not so much what they say about their childhood, it's about how clearly and organized their account of it is. Okay, and then if you measure the children of that adult quite separately and apart from this in a blind way, you can predict with that if in the adult attachment the adult gives a very cohesive and coherent account of his own relations or her own relations, you can bet that the kids are securely attached. That's a pretty interesting finding.
I did actually know what this was. I just didn't know that that's what it was called, the strange situation test.
Okay.
And I was listening to a I don't know, an online conference, psychology or whatever, and they were talking about this, and they said you can predict what a child's attachment style is going to be before they're even born, based on the parents'
you can predict
attachment
in the,
style.
In take having the
or what it's going to be 18. That's what it was. Yeah.
The third trimester of both the mother and the father,
yeah.
And you can predict the attachment style at 1 year of age for with the mother and the father, and it's reliable.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's quite amazing, isn't it?
So the attachment between the parents, between themselves? Or
No, with the child. Yeah, and that's why when we do infant observation, we really encourage people to meet the family in the third trimester to get a feel of what it is that the parent is expecting, and then to follow the observation for a year and see what happens. I mean, we're not doing any strange situation tests, but you can pretty much see exactly how the whole thing unfolds.
Follow-up question.
Maybe you need to come up, though, with a quick
to ask the question so you can be heard.
Just a follow-up question. You've carried it forward to 18 years. Any more longitudinal studies after that?
Yeah,
what happens
yeah.
to the
yeah, there are. I'm not as
child's
familiar.
Coping structure?
I'm not as familiar with the anything after infancy, but the work has been done. It's in the literature. So they have used the strange situation and the adult attachment interview with adolescents. But, of according to this theory, unless there's an intervention that's meaningful, your attachment category at 1 year of age is stable throughout your life. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's the intervention that becomes the meaningful change.
What are the names of those categories again?
Strange situation. Is that what you're talking
no,
about?
The four categories.
The categories of
attachment.
Secure
attachment. Insecure.
Secure attachment, insecure avoidant, insecure ambivalent, and disorganized. And this categorization has been done in some very different cultures, Africa, Uganda, other parts of the world, so it seems to be fairly
reliable
across cultural settings.
And you can get this adult attachment interview online.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And implicitly here, there's a big argument in favor of... I won't just say psychoanalysis or psychoanalytic therapy, but there's a big implications for therapy here, because people who have had therapy are people who can put together a coherent narrative of how their relations now are reflective of their childhood. This is what we get out of psychotherapy, which means our kids stand a much better chance of being securely attached.
But there is a category called earned security.
What is that, Michael? You need to come up
so
people can hear you.
That. No one has heard you anywhere other than this room.
You're not doomed forever as a result of this category.
Right.
Yeah.
There's a category called earned security,
right,
where you can convert one of the insecure ones based on life experience, therapy, just life, whatever,
right,
and you can, quote, earn a higher badge.
Yeah, but that's not the original categories.
No,
That's just the hope.
No,
there's some research supporting
research on that.
Yeah, but that's not the original Ainsworth.
No.
This is later stuff.
Yeah.
But
we're talking history.
Right.
Well, but we should give people hope as well.
No, but someone did ask.
I was asking his question.
Okay.
He answered.
Okay, he answered.
Yeah, yeah. So there are.
Shaver writes on attachment. Okay, Mucklinser talks about adult attachment styles, and people are trying to put that together with marriage, romance, attraction, all that kind of stuff.
Right. Yeah, one of the things that would enable you to radically modify your attachment style is you find your way into a good marriage. You know, you find someone who loves you and who you can trust and who is there, and now you gotta, you know, you're experiencing something of a secure attachment now. You know, my former colleague Morris Eagle came out with a book just this year or 2 years ago or something. It's reviewed in the latest issue of the Canadian Journal of Psychoanalysis. And it looks to me, I haven't read it either, but it looks to me like a pretty comprehensive study. Morris is a research psychologist. He's no ideologue. He's interested in science. He's interested in research results. And he's reviewing the whole field of attachment theory. So if you want to read further on attachment theory, Morris Eagle's book, I think, would be one place. But there's a vast literature on this now, just to let you know about Eagle's work. I don't plan to go into too much more. I think we need to say a word about how, you know, Bowlby initially took a pretty behavioristic stance. I mean, he's looking at primates, and we study them from the outside. And he's taking the position of an external observer, even the strange situation. Test is a kind of observational study of the way children react in their behavior. We're not talking about internal worlds here. The early attachment theory kind of threw the internal world out the window, because Bowlby was reacting against Melanie Klein, and so the internal world was lost. But and you know the same thing happened in early self-psychology. They weren't talking about the internal world either. But in both attachment theory and in self-psychology, over time, they start smuggling the internal world back in again. And they start becoming moving more back to the center of object relations theory. So the way this is done in attachment theory is they begin talking about internal working models. So we're now talking about internal states. Just as in self-psychology. Self-psychologists early on, they really defined themselves against object relations theory. They were not talking about internal self and object representations at all. But gradually, in the work of Brandschaft, Bernard Brandschaft, they started moving, bringing in the idea of internal objects or internal self and object images again. So we're getting. So my point is that attachment theory has moved over time closer to mainstream object relations theory in terms of bringing an internal world back in. Do you, either you or Michael have anything more to say that's crucial to say about attachment theory right now?
That's good.
We've covered some of the main concepts.
There's a question.
Yeah.
The only thing I would just add is, of course, there's the...
You might have to come closer.
Yeah, come closer.
I'm thinking... there's no way I'm sitting on your mind.
Okay.
I'm just thinking of the Harlow's monkeys, of course.
Yes.
I'm just referencing Harlow's monkeys.
Mm-hmm.
And the, in terms
wire
of primatology,
monkeys.
The wire monkeys,
mm-hmm. Right.
And which came later, of course, which also is a very brute
mm-hmm.
instance, certainly amongst primates, of what you're describing.
Not that much later. I mean, Bowlby himself
60s.
Refers to Harlow.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I think Harlow's original
exploit. But he was before.
1956.
But wasn't Harlow, I mean... I'm thinking of the videos that I've seen,
uh-huh.
which probably were from the 60s.
Yeah,
the
actual writing about the actual experiments were done in the mid-50s. And
do they know about this?
And
yeah.
Well, everybody knows about this, so I don't need to talk about wire... Do I need to talk about wire monkeys and stuff?
You
no.
Do.
I have no idea.
Yeah,
oh, all right, okay. Well, it's a very
monkeys.
Simple experiment.
you can find
to,
it on
I mean,
YouTube, by
choice.
The way.
You want
you can
to find
see
out
everything
if you had a wire
You can see the videos. There's two mothers. There's a wire mother with a spigot that feeds. And there's another wire mother that's covered with terry cloth and that also feeds. And the baby rhesus monkeys prefer the cloth-covered. So it's not just enough to get fed. There's also about contact stimulus that's going on.
But moreover,
well.
They would also, if I may, the baby monkeys that were only given
the wire feeding right.
became almost psychotic, extremely
right.
anxious,
right.
and
right.
retreated to the corners of the room and.
Right.
Very stark.
And also were...
Couldn't play with anyone.
Couldn't play, couldn't
And
interrupt.
Couldn't have sex. They couldn't perform sex. They
didn't
couldn't
remember that bit.
No, I
yeah,
didn't.
Yeah, no,
they
must have repressed that. Proper
I repressed
monkeys.
It.
They weren't paying attention.
No, that's true. They could not. They couldn't mate properly.
That's what it's called.
Yeah, mating. Okay. So then shifting...
question?
Yes.
But you have to come up, because that's the only way they can hear you.
They can't
you.
Hear you unless you come up.
You might
but no
try screaming into the microphone.
Well, it doesn't matter. Come.
Okay.
How can a question have no content?
Well, the content will be in your answer.
Yeah.
Can you comment on like adult attachment? It seems like a lot of attachment just refers to like childhood attachment, but how does that translate to adult attachment? There was a reference to
well,
things being stable over life, but
right.
is that, are they the same attachment patterns?
Yeah,
and
yeah they're the same.
So that's it?
That's
so adult
it.
Attachment is basically
the same
attachment?
It.
Unless you get therapy or get into
yeah.
a new healing relationship,
yeah.
you're going to have the same attachment pattern
yeah.
that showed up at age one or whatever.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. Easy. Thanks.
So this is an advertisement to go to therapy. Right, everyone
well,
should be in therapy.
It has that implication. I mean, I have a question for other people here. I mean, how much do you think awareness of these different attachment styles, how prominent do you think that role that plays in the work of your average psychodynamically oriented clinician nowadays in work with adults? I mean, how much do you think adult therapists actually use this research and think about it? Elizabeth's nodding, no.
They don't. They don't. We have tried very hard to interest training programs in including this, but it's a very resistant. They're very resistant.
Right. Mm-hmm. You mentioned last week something about the different therapeutic styles. Mm-hmm. Where the person's with some sort of schizoidal detachment.
Yes.
I forget the four categories you had, but it seems to parallel these four categories. Secure attachment. There seems to be a schizoidal.
Oh, I was talking about the four fields of therapeutic work. Working with patients who bring metaphor and who are neurotic, patients mm-hmm. who bring induced strong emotional states in us. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, I just saw a bit of a parallel, at least at the schizoidal link between the two.
Then there was the lie barrier system. Yeah. Yeah, I see. We'd have to work on that. I'm not sure how much of a parallel there is there, but that's an interesting possible.
Also, you mentioned before that some people, like, for example, the schizoidal ones, they tend to withdraw.
Yes.
Tend to have more difficulty relating transference, things along that line.
Yeah, yeah. So the schizoid personality has marked resemblances to insecure avoidant.
Mm-hmm. There's quite a literature on working with adults using attachment theory
right.
thinking.
Question
yeah.
over here.
I think this is being talked about a lot more in trauma work
mm-hmm.
now, and especially with like couples.
Uh-huh.
In trauma.
In couples work,
or.
Right.
Or not necessarily even in couples work, but in relation to sort of, like if I was in therapy with you and I wanted to talk about my relationship and
right.
why my relationship isn't working, even if we're not in couples therapy together,
mm-hmm.
Then this kind of stuff is brought in because obviously my, you know, if I have trauma and my relationship isn't working, it may be related to my attachment
right.
style. So I think that it's being brought in that realm
right.
more in.
Yeah, I'm using it in my own work, especially with couples,
mm-hmm.
But more broadly, when I'm assessing a new patient, I'm paying attention to this in my
mm-hmm.
first few interviews with a new patient. Yeah.
Isn't it sort of implicitly done in terms of, like, transference and things of that sort? Wouldn't transference have some sort of, and how well the transference is conducted have a lot to do with that and
right.
Well,
you
know,
in terms
it seems
of
to me like there's already an attachment. There's a relationship that
right.
goes, and you're saying you have people who have lie barrier problems. Well,
right.
they probably score somewhere poor on attachment,
yeah, yeah, yeah,
right?
Exactly.
And so they're not able to make that sort of tacit connection that's emotional connection and transference.
Right.
Would that be fair?
I think so. I mean, you know, with garden variety. You know, fairly well-functioning neurotic people, you know, they come into treatment and the therapist is fairly relaxed because they may not have had a perfectly secure attachment, but their tendency is to be fairly securely attached, and they're going to form a fairly secure attachment to the therapist, and you can feel this almost from the beginning. I mean, you're not sitting on the edge of your chair with these patients. They don't make you feel like you're walking in a minefield. They don't make you feel like the connection between you and the patient is hanging by a thread. You know, you relax and get on with listening and carrying on because there's a secure attachment to the therapist being carried over in the transference. Whereas some other patients who are avoidant, they give you the feeling they could leave you in a split second.
Mm.
You know, you can't relax and count
mm-hmm.
on them to hang in with the therapy. And then the disorganized people have got you really scratching your head. You don't know what you're getting tangled up with here. So I do think that these categories have real clinical relevance to doing therapy, and I think therapists should be aware of this and should be, especially in terms of doing initial assessments of someone for psychotherapy. It's pretty
the research says that
Michael's got to come forward to be heard.
Michael.
Poor guy.
Michael.
Just say, the research on disorganized attachment is
the,
a strong contributor to borderline.
The research
right.
on disorganized attachment, Michael says, has strong implications for the borderline personality disorder.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. As written by Fonagy and Tarjé.
Fonagy and Tarjé.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess we should say a word. Well, I made the point that internal working models, the work on that is an attempt to bring the internal world back in, but so is the whole theme of mentalization,
mm-hmm.
and the whole theme of so-called theory of mind, which is the child's developing capacity to recognize and to think that other people have minds and have states of mind. I mean, it's the basis of the ability to be able to empathize. And I just recently came across some new research that is showing, that claims to have shown theory of mind in certain primate species. They've done some experiments that show that, I forget whether they were chimps or what primate it was, but they were able to anticipate that another chimp has got a false belief and is going to be looking for something in the wrong place.
Oh, yeah.
So he can anticipate what's going on in the mind of the other animal, and he can anticipate that the other animal is going to look for something in the wrong place. So we're finding theory of mind going on in certain animal species now as well. Okay, so we've got time. Shall I shift now to talking about Erik Erikson? Let's start on Erik Erikson now. So, Erikson. The trouble with Erikson is he's too damn polite. You know, he actually offers a substantial critique of Freud, but you'd never know it unless you read Erikson really carefully. You know, because he was a lost soul. He was he didn't have a university degree. He was a hippie, wandering, and then he ran into some people that drew him to the Anna Freud School. Through Dorothy Burlingham, and they made him a teacher. He became a Montessori teacher. No university education. And then he was drawn into the orbit of Anna Freud, and she trained him, analyzed him, trained him as a child psychotherapist. He went on to become a full professor at Harvard without a BA degree.
You're kidding! I didn't know any of this.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. And he had this, no wonder he wrote about identity and identity crisis, because he had a huge identity problem himself. You know, his mother initially advertised that he was the son that she had with her husband, Homburger. Both the mother and the father were small and dark. And Erikson was like 6'4" and blonde. And at some point it came out that the mother admitted that Homburger was not the father. He had heard whisperings among his Jewish relatives that there were mysteries about this. And of course all of the school kids and the people in the neighborhood were mocking him, and there were jokes, you know, because he could... the mother finally admitted that Homburger was not his father. She claimed that her first husband was his father, and he accepted that for a while, and then it turned out that was a lie too. And the mother admitted that that was a lie, and she never would admit to him who the real father was.
Mm.
He imagined that the father was some Danish tall blonde nobleman type.
Is that where the name comes from?
Well, you see, the thing is, he calls him, there's a whole thing, he was attacked in the 70s for his name. Erik, Erik's son. He drops the name Homburger, and he was attacked by this writer as what's called a father ablator. A father ablator is someone who wants to disown his father and who doesn't want to owe anything, any patrimony. He doesn't want to... Norman O'Brown had the concept of the causa sui project, meaning causa sui, I am the cause of myself. I don't owe anything to a father. I'm my own father. I'm Erik's son. Erickson was already on in years when he was attacked this way in the New York Review of Books, and he, for whatever reason, never gathered himself to really, it was Marshall Berman who wrote the attack, and Erickson never really responded. He should have responded. You know, unfortunately, my friend Paul Rosen also kind of joined in the attack a little bit on Erickson. His biographers say, you know, rather than being a father ablator, he really was a father seeker. He didn't know who his father was. He had a real identity crisis. It's out of his severe adolescent identity crisis that came his understanding and his compassion for young people who have identity crises. Some parallels have been made with Harry Stack Sullivan. Harry Stack Sullivan seems to have maybe have had a psychotic break in his late teens or early 20s. He seemed to drop off the map for a few years. There's speculation that he was hospitalized. Anyway, he came out of that with deep compassion for schizophrenics and chose to work with schizophrenics and made major contributions of a psychoanalytic sort to the understanding of schizophrenia because of his own breakdown. Well, Erickson maybe didn't have exactly a breakdown. He was a lost soul until he was taken in by the Freudian establishment. No wonder he was polite. No wonder he muted his criticisms, because Freud was kind of a father, revered father figure for him. But, you know, he went on to write about Luther, young man Luther. Erickson was a psychohistorian and a psychobiographer. And that book, Young Man Luther, is a brilliant study of Martin Luther. And of Martin Luther's breakdown that occurred in a particular day. Poor Martin Luther. I mean, the way Erickson describes him, I mean, Luther was beaten by his father. He had this incredibly demanding, harsh superego concept of God. God as a harsh, demanding superego. And he was into, what do the Catholics call that sin where you just won't accept forgiveness and you just keep trying harder and harder to, there's a special word that describes this. Anyway, he was praying harder than anyone to try to redeem himself and win God's love and forgiveness, and nothing he did was ever enough until finally he has this crisis in which he suddenly recognizes a whole new concept of God. And he finds the roots of this in the New Testament writings, and this is a forgiving God who already has forgiven you. And is no longer this harsh taskmaster who's impossible to please. And Erickson is writing about Luther. He's also identified with Luther. He later goes on to write about Gandhi, another father figure for him. And of course, he has this lifelong interest in Christianity. His mother was a passionate follower of Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard, passionate Christian. She was reading and encouraging him as a boy to read Kierkegaard. So here he is in this ostensibly Jewish home with the Jewish father, Homburger, and the mother is getting him to read Kierkegaard. Now, Jesus is also a figure of uncertain paternity.
Depends on who you ask.
Right. So he's pretty identified with this. He marries a Canadian Anglican, Joan Serson. And so in his later years, he's attending church with his wife, Anglican. And he's having long conversations with their Anglican priest. He never converted. He never got baptized. But it looks kind of like he was on the way to doing that. Okay, he even though he soft pedals his critique of Freud, he calls Freud's model of man a centaur, half human, half beast. And he's absolutely right. That is Freud's view of man. Ego and superego is the human half, id is the animal half. The id is composed of the drives, which are rooted in the body, somatic sources. Erikson is very critical of this, but in such a polite way, you'd hardly even know there was a critique there. I mean, Erikson was on to the whole idea that the Freudians thought that our sociality is a secondary layer imposed on our animality. Erikson radically disagrees with that. He sees that we are intrinsically social. There are connections with attachment theory there. We're social to begin with. He revises Freud's theory in the sense that whereas Freud would see orality as stemming from the mouth and the lips and the tongue, and he would see anality stemming from the anus and the phallic Oedipal stemming from the genitals and so on. Erikson reverses this, and he sees all of these as different modes of relatedness. Here's the social again, the relatedness. We can relate to other people through our mouths and lips and tongues. We can relate to people anally. We can relate to people in a phallic way. So the bodily zones, instead of being the sources, the body for Erikson is no longer the source. It's merely a vehicle. The body, the different body parts and zones are simply vehicles for different modes of relatedness. We are fundamentally social. We are fundamentally wanting to relate to other people. So there's a real reversal of Freud here. And then, of course, he famously expands Freud's theory of development. I mean, Freud really believed that the story was told by age 5. The Oedipus complex is really what crystallizes who you are, and you may be able to make some minor adjustments later. But basically, by age 5 or 6, personality is formed, structured. Erikson extends this to 8 stages from 5. And therefore, he acknowledges that there can be major personality change, certainly in adolescence and young adulthood, and also again in midlife, even, that personality for Erikson is not nearly so determined early on as it was for Freud. He sort of reconceives in much more social terms the challenge at each stage of development. So the first year of life, infancy, there's a conflict at each stage. And the conflict in the first year is basic trust versus mistrust. If you resolve that in favor of basic trust, you acquire a virtue, the virtue of hope. Okay, you come out of a relatively good infancy. Mother has been more reliable than unreliable. The world seems to be a trustworthy place. There may be frustrations, but in the long run, the world responds to my needs. So this is the basis of hope. He's adding a virtue. The successful resolution of the conflict at each stage conveys a particular virtue. Now, that's really kind of a radical change in Freudian theory, because he's talking about virtues. I believe that psychoanalysis has always been interested in ethics. I believe that it's an intrinsically ethical enterprise, but Freud went out of his way to disguise this fact. We saw back in 1914 where Freud is conceiving the task as moving from narcissism to object love. Freud actually says, unless I begin to love, I must fall ill, and must fall ill if I can't love. Okay, that's a moment when Freud drops the disguise that this is science, and he drops the disguise that this is medicine. He's saying this whole therapy business is an ethical practice, whereby we take people who can't love, and we try to convert them into loving people. That's what this business is all about. But psychoanalysis has wanted to hide this fact, and therefore Erikson got into trouble, because Erikson unembarrassedly starts talking about virtues. Okay, so second year of life, early childhood, the conflict is autonomy versus shame and doubt. Autonomy, not just that I can gain control over my sphincter muscle, and toilet training becomes possible, but I can control motility, I'm able to walk. I'm also learning language, and one of the first words I learn is no. You can't make me. No, I won't, you know. So declarations of independence and autonomy, and versus shame when autonomy fails. So I remember ignominiously coming home from my kindergarten with my mat soaked because during my nap, I peed all over the mat, and the shame, a failure of autonomy, right? But if you come out of that second stage with a sense of autonomy, you develop a sense of will. Freedom of the will to some degree, the ability to will certain things and to self-control. Play stage, 3 to 6 years, the Oedipal phase, initiative versus guilt. Under initiative, of course, there are the child's sexual initiatives towards one parent and rivalry with the other parent and the siblings. Is the child coming out of that stage crippled with guilt and inhibition, or is the child coming out of that stage being able to take initiatives and assert himself and have purpose? That's the virtue that comes out of the Oedipal phase, the capacity to form purposes and aims and goals and pursue them. School age, 6 to 12 years, the conflict is industry versus inferiority. The child is now having to cope with school and peers. And so does he come out of that with a sense of competence, capability, or a sense of incompetence and incapability? Adolescence, 12 to 19. Here's the famous identity crisis. Does he wind up having a sense of identity, or does he come out with identity confusion, or what Erikson sometimes calls identity diffusion? If he comes out of this with a sense of identity versus confusion or diffusion, he acquires the virtue of fidelity, being able to be faithful, not just to a person, but to a cause, or to one's own ideals, or to oneself. Fidelity. By the way, Otto Kernberg takes Erikson's concept of identity diffusion and makes it a central defining feature of the borderline personality disorder, who suffers from identity diffusion. Early adulthood, we're now into one of the stages that he's adding on here. Early adulthood, 20 to 25 years of age, intimacy versus isolation, capacity to form intimate relationships as opposed to being isolated. The virtue is the capacity to love. Adulthood, 26 to 64, generativity versus stagnation. Generativity meaning really transcending narcissism, realizing it's no longer all about me. And it's no longer about establishing a self, but in some sense being able to let go of a self and welcome the next generation onto the stage. Being able to generate something beyond myself. It doesn't have to be biological generation. It could be generation of in the arts, generate creativity in any field, as opposed to stagnation. And the virtue that comes out of that is the virtue of care. And then old age, 65 to death, integrity versus despair. Can the person wind up with a sense of having had a meaningful life, having had a good life, and maybe even having had enough already? Instead of like the bitter old man clinging to life, but maybe even welcoming the idea of a final rest. Because I've been there, I've done that. Overall, I did a pretty good job. I could have done better, of course. I made some mistakes, of course. But overall, I'm fairly satisfied. Time to push away from the table. You know, instead of just more, 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 me, me, me. Erickson writes, I think, with a lot of wisdom about old age. Actually, and he says a lot of things that are very similar to what one of my favorite writers, Terry Eagleton, wrote a wonderful little book on death. Oh, no, sorry, on evil. The book is on evil. But in the course of that book, he says that, life... should be a preparation for death. He talks about how we need practice during life in what he calls self-depossession or self-dispossession. In other words, we need to learn to dispossess ourselves of ourselves. We need to get over ourselves. We need to get past ourselves. Again, this is overcoming narcissism. And he says that a person who hasn't gained practice at getting past himself in life is not going to be able to have a good death, because death is the ultimate act of self-dispossession. It's the ultimate act of letting go of the self. It's a really interesting discussion. I think Erickson is saying something along the same lines as what Erickson is saying here. And so the virtue that comes out of that is wisdom. So here we have Erickson talking about hope, will, purpose, competence, fidelity, love, care, wisdom. So, I mean, he's an explicitly ethical writer. He's writing about values and ethics. And Roazen and Berman take him to task for this. They both see themselves as hard-headed scientific Marxists. And they're sort of saying, you know, look, Freud's revolution, psychoanalysis, you know, represented a development beyond that old moralism, be it Christian moralism or Jewish moralism or any moralism. And now here's Erickson bringing morals back in and thus misrepresenting and falsifying the true spirit of psychoanalysis. That's what they said. I think they're profoundly wrong. I think that what Erickson was simply doing was giving explicit voice to what psychoanalysis is and always has been, but has lied to itself and to the world about what it has been. I don't think he's bringing values into a discipline that has transcended them. I think he's being honest about the values that have always guided it. Yes.
But aren't the values like our instincts? And isn't that showable through science? Because you seem to create a dualism there and suggest that somehow ethics is this kind of mathematical thing that you can drive that isn't really reality.
Little louder, please.
Yeah. You're going to have to come forward and formulate.
I'll teach you for speaking up.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if... if there isn't such a duality, if analysis is a science, but that our intrinsic morality or ethics is an instinct that is being uncovered by analysis, and rather than some sort of mathematical formalism that you can derive and then describe in philosophy.
Okay, I'll try to answer your question. I'm not sure I really understand the question.
I'm countering your point that Erickson is describing the true analysis, which is that it's an ethical formalism,
right,
but rather that rather than being dualistic, they're one and the same, that the science of analysis is uncovering the intrinsic instinct,
okay,
which is ethics.
Okay. Well, I think Erickson would entirely agree with you.
Okay. But both would agree. Like, his critics should agree with him as well.
Yeah, but they don't. that's why I disagree with them.
Right.
I mean, I disagree with Rose and Berman about this.
But
I think
he's not unscientific.
It depends on what we mean by science, but I mean, Erickson certainly felt that psychoanalysis in a broad sense was a humanistic science, and he felt that psychoanalysis was intrinsically revealing these values as part of the unfolding of personality. He didn't
like Chomsky.
Well, he wasn't writing about Chomsky.
He wasn't, but like Chomsky, it's an unfolding.
It's an unfolding of something,
yeah,
that's rooted in our nature.
Yeah.
I think Erickson would agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Do we have any questions from there?
Oh,
maybe
are there any questions coming up from the people online? Not at the moment? Okay. Okay, we're okay. Okay. So he's extended his view of Freud's stages of epigenetics. See, he's talking about continuity with Freud. I mean, after all, he's working with Freud's stages, and he's simply elaborating on the epigenetic model that Freud gave us, extending it through youth, young adulthood, middle years to old age, acknowledging a greater capacity for development and change beyond childhood than Freud acknowledged. But there is this difference. For Erickson, the bodily zones, which for Freud were the sources of the drives, became instead vehicles for varying modes of relatedness. Okay. on this question of the ethics, here's a wonderful quotation from Erickson. Any psychotherapist who throws out his ethical sentiments with his irrational moral anger deprives himself of a principal tool of his clinical perception, unquote. I'll say it again. Any psychotherapist who throws out his ethical sentiments with his irrational moral anger deprives himself of a principal tool of his clinical perceptions. Now, I translate that into my terminology. Who throws out concern with conscience while at the same time correctly seeking to distance himself from superego. See, because I make the distinction between superego as this inner moralist and conscience as being about ethical sentiments. So he's saying therapists need conscience. We should create a non-judgmental atmosphere. We mustn't expose our patients to superego imposition of superego normative judgments. That's not our business. But we have to carry the conscience. And if we get confused and we don't make the distinction between superego and conscience, and in the name of non-judgmental, we throw out not just superego, but conscience, we're in trouble. Because what Erickson is saying is that the therapist needs conscience, he needs ethics, his ethical sentiments, as a principal tool of his clinical perception. Somewhere else I quoted, we just had a conference here on the weekend on a bunch of things, but including the work of Carl Stern, who was a psychiatrist, neurologist who came to Montreal and worked along psychoanalytic lines. And Stern wrote a really interesting paper on non-judgmental atmosphere and so on, and he made the point that while patients need to be protected against therapists' moralism, patients need to know that their therapist has a conscience. and they rely on that, and the therapy requires it. So Erickson was certainly on to this.
Just a quick reference. Are you talking to Donnell Stern?
No. I'm talking about Carl Stern. Donnell Stern is a contemporary relational psychoanalyst. Carl Stern wrote several books. One was called Flight from Woman. The other was called The Third Revolution. These are books written in the 1950s. You know, there he was in Montreal. He did develop he had an impact in the U.S. south of the border, but in Montreal he was extremely isolated because, first of all, he was a Jewish man who converted to Roman Catholicism. Just at the outbreak of the Second World War, he came to Montreal and converted to Roman Catholicism. So here he was, a passionate Christian convert, Roman Catholic convert, and so the Jewish community in Montreal wanted nothing to do with him. The psychoanalytic community, he was close friends with Miguel Prados, with whom we still, in the Canadian psychoanalytic, we have a Prados Prize we give out every year. Prados was one of the early founders of the Canadian psychoanalytic movement, and he and Stern were close friends. In fact, Stern had some analysis from Prados, but Stern never entered the Canadian Psychoanalytic Society. He never had a formal analytic training. I think because he sensed that the Canadian Psychoanalytic Society didn't want any part of a passionate Christian convert any more than the Jewish community wanted. So he was very isolated in Montreal, but he kept writing these amazing books, which had an impact south of the border. There were questions over here. Yeah.
Can you give an example of how you would, like, in therapy, like, how a client would know that the therapist has a conscience, but, like, without imposing, like, your own moral judgments? Or, do you know what I mean? Like, what that would look like?
Anyway, so it's a kind of a joining technique, whereby you can't scold and moralize, but at the same time, you find fairly subtle ways of communicating the fact that, yeah, you got a conscience. You know? That's part of the art. Let's face it, psychoanalysis is an art. And, you know, let's face it, here we are sitting in a training institute. Training institutes don't want to admit something. Training institutes operate on the principle that anyone who has the right training can do the work. This is not true. Some people have a talent for doing therapy, and other people don't. And the people who don't can have as much, they can train for 30 years, they'll never get it. But we don't want to admit that. Okay, Erickson writes about identity crisis. Recently here, I talked about my identity crisis. I spotted Freud's introductory lectures on my dad, family doctor, on his bedside table. I quickly decided I would follow him into medicine, then do psychiatry, and then do psychoanalysis. But I should have developed doubts about the wisdom of this plan in light of what I call the three episodes. My dad had a home office, and on weekends he didn't have a nurse, so some kid would fall off a bike and cut open his head, and my father would have to stitch him up. And I'm 10 or 11, and he calls me down to his study. Now, you know, if your father has this room in his basement with this white table with the white cloth with all of these sharp knives laid out, and you know something about castration anxiety, you can imagine what that is like for a boy. Okay, so he calls me down to his surgery, and my job now is to snip the stitches, right? And I see the blood, and the room gets foggy, and I wake up later on the floor. And my father kept trying. Three times this happened. I passed out all three times. But I still didn't add it up that medicine was not the career for me, right? So the crisis, the Ericksonian identity crisis, came in first year university, and I suddenly realized there's no way I'm doing all this chemistry and biology. There's no way I'm learning to cut up cadavers. There's no way I'm learning to do rectal examinations. And so I drop out of pre-med science and switch to SOC and PHIL, as it was called, social and philosophical studies. And I thought, well, there goes any hope I ever had of becoming a psychoanalyst. It wasn't until about third year undergraduate that I discovered the writings of Eric Fromm, PhD, sociologist, psychoanalyst. And so I immediately, hope was renewed. I wrote a PhD dissertation on sociology and psychoanalysis, immediately entered training. And why this was so important is because my father, I mean, I loved being an academic, I loved being a teacher, but my father had patience. I had to have patience in order to reintegrate my identification with my father. I had to get patience. Becoming an analyst, I got patience. Finally, I could be with my dad again. Okay, so this is all about identity crisis. I had the identity crisis in first year university, and then I found a way to... Now, what does Erikson say about forming a stable ego identity? It's a twofold thing. It involves individual psychology, but it also involves social psychology. On the individual level, to form a viable ego identity, you have to somehow work out a gestalt, an integration, a synthesis of the many disparate self-images from every stage of development. And you got to integrate your identifications with mother, your identifications with father. You got to somehow bring it all together in a package of some sort, an organization. Otherwise, you're going to be a fragmented self. You have to work out a synthesis. That's on the individual level. But it's not going to work unless that synthesis finds social recognition, confirmation, validation by a social community that almost gives the blessing to the organization that you've worked out and also offers you a sense of belonging. And I was explaining why the Toronto Psychoanalytic Society is so important to me. I mean, I got patience, and then I got a community that gave its blessing to this identity that I had worked out. So Erikson is really good about this, the need not just to work out the synthesis on the individual level, but to package it in a way that gets a community to say, yeah, right on, we like it, it works, come and join us, you know. It's really hard for people. I feel sorry for the younger generation of kids these days. It's harder to find that. It's ever harder to put that together and to get the recognition. I mean, there are so few tenure track positions available for young scholars these days. It's a very sad situation. Anyway, Erikson is brilliant on identity crisis and on how to put together an ego identity and what the pathology looks like when that has not been adequately achieved. And he was very sensitive. He was at Austin Riggs, and you know, he just listened to young people in crisis, adolescents and young people in crisis, and he did a thorough psychosocial. His wife was an occupational therapist. He was very influenced by his wife, art therapy. He had a very holistic way of listening to patients. Nowadays, troubled adolescents have drugs thrown at them almost from the get-go. Mm-hmm. Erikson listened with great empathy, because obviously he'd had a major identity crisis of his own, and he understood what that was all about. Okay, it's 10 mm-hmm. o'clock. We're going to have to hold it. Next week, we're going to do Eric Fromm in detail. And then the week after that, we'll do Kohut, Kernberg, and a little bit of Lacan. But I'm not going to be able to do very much Lacan.
The final week?
The final week, yeah. We'll do Kohut, Kernberg, and a bit of Lacan the final week. But next week is going to be mostly Eric Fromm. Okay?
I have a quick question about the quote on the...